we are beginning our second keynote of the winter school, and I came across this book. It's called Caste and Nature. 2 years back, it was introduced to me by Mahesh Rangarajan, and I was really fascinated with this book because nature as a concept or environment as a concept, we often don't relate that with caste. And so I read that book. It was very fascinating, and I didn't realize that after 2 years I'll be inviting the author of the book to the winter school. And it's a very interesting, lot of interesting issues about Dalit environmentalism, caste, nature, and environmental issues and social issues. And it fits very well in our winter school, because in winter school we are actually looking at overlap of multiple domains: social, biological, ecological, economics. But interestingly, social justice and caste doesn't often fit in well with environmental discourses. So this is a very interesting talk, and I'm very pleased and privileged to introduce and welcome Mukul Sharma. He's a professor at Indian Institute of Mass Communication, New Delhi. He has a multidisciplinary and diverse background in academics, research, development, and media. Combining these disciplines of development, environment, media, he has published 16 books and several booklets in English and Hindi, the latest being Caste and Nature, Dalits and Indian Environmental Politics. And another interesting book, if you have not come across, is a book called Green and Saffron. The title of the book is Green and Saffron, Hindu Nationalism and Indian Environmental Politics. His other publications include Human Rights in a Globalized World and Indian Diary. And the other book is called Contested Coastlines, Fisherfolk, Nations, Borders in South Asia. And he's currently working on themes such as eco-religion, sacrality, politics in South Asia. So thank you so much, Mukul, for coming. Please join me in welcoming.
I think I will be. Am I audible?
Yes.
So thanks, Abhika. Thanks, Ghazala, for inviting me. And finally, I'm here. And again, thanks to all of you for being here. And so before I'm not very comfortable with PowerPoint and all these things, but anyway, some clarification before I begin my talk here for 45-50 minutes, and followed by your question, that when we say caste or Dalit specifically, then I deploy the term Dalit in a larger, inclusive, encompassing sense. We all are aware of this fact that this category Dalit itself does not mean a single caste. There are many castes, sub-castes within this broad framework, and they all have different, multiple, complex narrative of nature and their ecological arguments. So that is one clarification. Second, that when I say Indian environmentalism, then again, we all know that this Indian environmentalism is extremely heterogeneous, and there are many streams within Indian environmentalism. In the context of caste, Dalit, nature, I will be talking about certain strands of Indian environmentalism. So one doesn't want to characterize all stream of environmentalism here. However, some of these streams which I will be referring are quite prominent, quite strong, visible, audible. So that is second. Third is, please bear with my throat because I'm coming from Delhi and you all know the Delhi pollution and after the Vijayadashmi. So the third, that I will be taking many material from my book, which is already there in the public domain. After my talk or question answer, you can always go back to my book, which will be also coming out in Hindi in the coming month. And fourthly, Ghazala has also asked me to include a few specific points on research methodology. What did I do to make this research possible? In between, I will be also speaking about, or during the course of discussion, we can also touch upon about the various research methodologies that I try to deploy. Because when you are working on caste, Dalit, then of course, you need to go beyond the fixed boundaries of research, and you need to deploy various kind of materials or Dalit products or things to understand this topic broadly. So let's begin with the Indian environmental politics, which has been variously vividly defined as environmentalism of the poor, indigenous environmentalism, middle class environmentalism, elite environmentalism, eco-feminism, red and green, green and saffron I worked on, and much more, revealing its diversity and dynamics. Environmental themes and concerns appear across a diverse spectrum of organizations, groups, and movements, we all know. Scholarship on environmental issues and movements and debates on development have particularly focused on the voices and visions of women and tribals. We have a lot of literature, rich literature here. However, while Dalits have often participated in significant numbers in various environmental movements, initiatives that you all, I think, must have experienced, they have been largely missing in most studies as a category, the way people have focused on tribal or women, as they are usually merged in the general definition of poor, marginal, depressed, displaced, environmental refugees and migrants, and so on and so forth. There appears to be, and here I am making a statement based on my research, there appears to be an environmental blindness on questions of caste, or an understanding of a specifically Dalit position on ecological politics. And mind this, this is not only my critique. Of late, many Dalit and anti-caste intellectuals have begun questioning ecological and political trajectories of contemporary environmentalism in India. For example, a small but significant piece by academician Gail Ombeth titled Why Dalits Dislike Environmentalists or Environmentalism pointed to the alienation between the two of the most powerful social movements in India, that is the anti-caste movement and the environmental movement. Dalit intellectual Chandrabhan Prasad, in another article titled The New Life Movement versus Narmada Bachao Andolan, invoked Ambedkar's notion of a new life movement, his ideas on modernization, and his critique of Gandhian traditionalism as arguments for the rejection of the Narmada Bachao Andolan in general and Medha Patkar in particular. We all must be knowing about Medha Patkar. I hope we can spell her name here. Academician and activist, well-known, Kancha Elahi, refers to environmentalism, the Indian environmentalism, as exclusive, devoid of any concerns and relationship with the builders of environment on earth. He argues that this so-called secular Indian environmentalism is not bothered about the nationalist and hegemonic social structure that Brahmanism has built in India. This is Kancha Ilahi. Examples from several environmental movements also bring out their caste blindness, or more importantly, their implicit pro-caste and anti-Dalit bias. Movements like the Narmada Bachao Andolan and the Chilka Bachao Andolan in Odisha certainly deployed a creative redefinition of human rights by closely linking their movements with right to life and livelihood. But issues of Dalits and caste discrimination were neglected throughout in course of those movements. An examination of Narmada Bachao Andolan revealed that the movement's areas and the villages continued to be characterized by higher caste domination. Caste discrimination was an everyday reality. Dalit participation in the movement was very limited. Dalits had not been part of the decision-making processes. They were lacking in confidence to participate in the movement, and no organization existed for them and the landless laborers. My own study, which is part of my book, Green and Saffron, which Ambika referred here, against Tehri Dam movement, led by Sundarlal Bahuguna and others, amply showed Dalits' discontent over the nature and demands of the movement, about the land, rehabilitation, and so on and so forth. So that is in detail in my previous work. So caste blindness of Indian environmentalism is also demonstrated the way they have idealized Indian village, community, tradition, and culture, combined sometimes with Gandhian perspective. They have often romanticized the Indian village, regarding it as an embodiment of tradition, an ideal place of homogeneity and harmony, and understanding village communities as little republics. Read environmental scholar Madhav Gadgil and Ramchand Guha. It's quote there, so I will not read it out. And the allure of the village has also provided a powerful medium to challenge urbanization and development in India. Similar is the conception of community by several prominent environmentalists. It could be village community, social community, or others. Environmentalists have often located community as a natural preserve of tradition, as outside modernity, a symbol of egalitarianism, homogeneity, and cooperation, and as offering an effective challenge to developmental model. Various imagination of community are repeatedly referred without interweaving it with questions of caste hierarchies and imbalanced shares in nature. Amidst such perspective, you can see the viewpoint of several Dalits and anti-caste intellectuals like of Ambedkar, Phule, Periyar, providing an entirely divergent understanding of the village and community. I can't get into details here. Take just one example, one instance of Ambedkar's account of Indian village. He presents them as a model of Hindu social organization, a microcosm, the working plant of the Hindu social order, where one could see the Hindu social order in operation in full swing, controlling habitations, natural resources, and economy of a village is seen as central, not only to the continuity of the Hindu social order, but also to its political and economic standings. See his candid conclusion about our so-called ideal in the Indian village. This is the Ambedkar. Ambedkar questions the notion of village community as a natural fact, as an innate little republic of Indian civilization, as an untouchable. And from that standpoint, he raised critical concerns on the linkages drawn
between nature and village. From his early writings on village to his responses to debates in the Constituent Assembly, Ambedkar highlighted a different, less celebratory theme in Indian thought, conceptualizing the Indian rural landscape not as golden, harmonious and innocent, but as a land of Hindu oppression and command, which should not be treated as a basic unit of Indian civilization or constitution. The caste blindness of Indian environmentalism, making Dalits low caste invisible, is the only one part of the story. The other part of the story, equally important, is the positive deployment of caste in understanding environment and nature within the framework of Brahminical Hinduism. I call this phenomena as eco-casteism. There are many versions of eco-casteism in contemporary Indian environmentalism. I will be able to deal only a few based on certain very, as I mentioned, very strong strand of Indian environmentalism. So some of our environmental discourses provide a defense of the caste system. Thus comes the explanation by Kailash Malhotra, a well-known anthropologist, and I quote, the caste system was actually based on an ancient concept of sustainable development, which disciplined the society by partitioning the use of natural resources according to specific occupations and created the right social milieu in which sustainable patterns of resource use were encouraged to emerge, unquote. Or says another, I quote, the Hindu caste system can be seen as a progenitor of the concept of sustainable development, unquote. Even the otherwise insightful ecological history of India by Madhav Gadgil and Ramchand Guha provides in effect a functional justification of caste as a system of ecological adaptation. According to them, caste groups bound with each other in supportive relationships had hereditary and specialized occupational functioning. Based on these groups, caste society had also developed a system of diversified resource use that greatly reduced inter-caste competition. Local belief system, key Hindu gods, and social conventions helped resource conservation and helped evolve a path of cooperation and coexistence. Thus they state, I quote, it is therefore appropriate to talk of the ecological niche of these various caste groups in terms of the habitats they occupy, the natural resources they utilize, and the relationship they bear to the other caste group with whom they interact, unquote. Gadgil and Guha further explain, I quote, as opposed to the exclusive approach favored by monotheist religions such as Islam and Christianity, Hinduism has relied more heavily on an inclusive framework that tries to incorporate rather than reject or convert apparently hostile sets and worldviews. The institutional mechanism for this process of incorporation is, of course, the caste system, unquote. The evolution of caste has sometimes been defined on the basis of the ecosystem, and the Varna structure has often called essentially ecological in its logic. The tropic system is described as the relationship between different forms of life according to their system metabolism, which is derived from the way different classes of organism convert energy into biomass. It is argued by another scholar, I quote, the maintenance of the Varna structure is therefore the key element in the performance of dharma. Given the criticality of this concept to the Brahminical system, it is interesting that this equilibrium structure appears to be derived from the ecological foundations, foundations that are readily revealed if we look at the Varna equations as a tropic system, unquote. And here comes the conclusion by Ashok Dasgupta, which I have quoted just now, I quote, "It is deeply provocative, but nonetheless logical to hold that the evolution of untouchability was in an ecological sense, something of the master stroke, which enhanced the competitive advantage of those populations that adopted it. Thus, would have developed a specialized population of decomposers, parasites, scavengers, and so on. This, in our view, is the ecological rationale for the adaptive success of untouchability, the latent principle in the Varna system," unquote. Others have equated caste with traditional or indigenous knowledge, which can very well combine nature, human, and supernature. It can take the shape of a traditional knowledge system providing public services at large. And anthropologist Ashok Dasgupta, in his article, "Is Caste System a Kind of Indigenous Knowledge System?" argues that caste system, a kind of division of labor, is an important indigenous knowledge system for Indian subcontinent, unquote. Some other environmentalists attempt to revive ideas of traditional caste-based occupations to make them newly applicable to contemporary needs and occasions. Modern toilets, sanitation, and sewage are condemned as Western systems inappropriate for India. And here I'm not talking about some very invisible, I'm here talking about WWF India, which is running a very big Vrindavan forest conservation program. So one is not talking about very unknown, somebody mad or something of that kind. Modern toilets, sanitation, and sewage are, of course, condemned as Western systems inappropriate for India. This is combined with a suggestion that an ideal place should have perfect sanitation of the traditional kind for disposing human waste. Ecological societies are those where toilets are dry, where waste is removed daily and composted. The lesson is, I quote, "Traditional systems that have worked for thousands of years should not be interfered with. There is usually a good reason why they have worked so long." A further lesson is that the Western system of sanitation, developed in a part of the world where water is plentiful, is inappropriate for India, where water is scarce and so valuable that it is considered sacred, unquote. Eco-casteism, an ecological determinant of caste, provides a rationalization and justification of caste system through nature. Caste identity becomes a key organizing framework for environment thought and actions. Dominant caste can certainly validate their power through such a conception. Eco-casteism, as propagated and practiced presently within the Indian environmentalism, combines with what I call eco-organicism and eco-naturalism. So I'm just cutting short the story here to be within the time. So eco-organicism is an Indian approach to nature where environment is understood as divine, cosmic, and intrinsic, conforming to the laws of nature. Society is viewed as natural, based on natural principles, whereby modernity, industry, science, technology are described as Western, materialist, and consumerist, and thus unnatural and uncultured and un-Indian. In such understandings, Indian environment is believed to be under threat from outside forces. Therefore, the protection of environment is synonymous with protection of Indian culture, tradition, and nation. Indian culture here consists comprehensively of our family, customs, faith, rituals, ceremonies, social systems, values, ethics, anything and everything. The binary of Indian and Western offers a wealth of environmental literature in India, in which Indianism, Brahmanism, and Hinduism are immersed to offer very straightforward solutions. I'm not getting into the many examples that are there. So now eco-naturalism is the coupling of environmental protection with the protection of life in its natural order. According to this view, humans have wrongly considered themselves as above nature, whereas they should be viewed as in nature, which is rich, permanent, cultural, and often provides national values to guide human actions. There can be several versions of eco-naturalism combining with eco-casteism and eco-organicism. For example, nature is above all, to whom humans must submit. Nature and its teaching give a model to govern politics and economy, and an ecological society should be run by nature's rule and cycle. There are ecological communities and societies based on certain tradition, culture, religion, and nationality. And we must return to those tradition and nationality and culture. Eco-naturalism uses nature to affirm the supremacy of natural order in major spheres of life, food, animal, livelihood, which is many times synonymous with a conservative Hindu Brahminical order. For example, take food. So much of debate around food, and here food is a part of ultimate reality Brahmin, which is culturally given, along with the designed social ritual phages, according to which multiple schemes of food classification and which is pure, which is impure, what should be appropriate to eat and not to eat can be prescribed based on ecological arguments within this framework. And I again quote a environmentalist, Ranchur Prime, that the bull represents dharma, moral principles, and the cow represents the earth. It is a tragedy that modern society does not appreciate the significance of caring for cows and bulls and prefers instead to kill them and eat them. However, Manu Smriti, the basic law book of Hinduism, considers the animal killer to be a murderer. It says that all involved in the act, the slaughterer, the butcher, the cook, and the one who eats the meat, are liable to nature's punishment. So, unquote. So you can see so much of punishment around in the name of food in our country. So purity and pollution of our body, touch, taste, space, place, people, are key markers of caste, we all know, creating essential qualities and differences within and outside the nature escapes. Nature itself cannot determine the identity of a place, but caste creates a natural essence and ambience to establish power relations and social order. Thus, we have vast landscapes of purity and pollution in India that maintain strict lines for caste identity, dominance, and exclusion, from sacred groves to natural water bodies, from village to city. These demarcations between cultural and uncultural, holy and unholy, natural and unnatural, are alive and active through natural and social dispositions. The caste of place is naturalized in many, many different ways. Boundaries of villages are identified with caste. Areas of ponds, wells, and rivers are marked by caste. Landfill sites have caste. There is thus a spatial dimensions of issue of power, hierarchy, and inequality. The fear is of pollution is not only about the outer nature, but also about the inner nature expressed with body and minds. However, in a caste society, purity and pollution can give negative as well as positive stimulus to bind or separate, unite or divide people spatially. Thus, space becomes a critical arena of environmental struggle or movements today. So, in these, So, in the above context, I have some other propositions on the interrelationship between caste, nature, and Dalit. We know nature is the natural world, considered as natural, universal, common and applicable to all, endowed with wide, unaccountable varieties of human species, animal, plants, land, consisting of all things. And we know how caste is a divisive, hierarchical human world, considered as constructed and distinct historical and social entity, unique to India, South Asia, and based on a system of stratification and division of society, especially Hindi society. We understand the diversity, multiplicity, durability, and elasticity in the meaning of nature and environment. We are also aware of the historicity, complexity, particularity, and display of caste, its theory and practice in India, so much of caste everywhere. My hypothesis is that caste and nature are intimately interwoven in India. We need to see this interconnectedness from a Dalit lens. I question the concept of universal environmentalism. My fieldwork and overall understanding suggests that Dalit experiences and narratives constantly underline their everyday ecological burdens in a marked hierarchical caste order. Images of land animate caste anxieties around labor, blood, and bondage. In dry regions, Dalits must often sacrifice their life to recharge pond and water resources. In fact, there is a case study of Gujarat that how Dalits had to sacrifice their life to recharge the pond and well and so on and so forth. From village to city and temple to school, caste metaphors of pollution, impurity, and dirt dominate places and spaces through imaginaries of dangers posed by the presence of Dalits. Forest can be a heaven and a hell for Dalits. A river is some place to dispose your body. Nature, entwined with fear and violence, horror and hardship, bloodbath and war, makes environmental experiences of Dalit distinct and different. In the context of Indian environmentalism and their caste blindness, eco-casteism and Dalit distinctive and different environmental experiences, how do I see Dalit's relationship with environment? So we know that Dalit intellectual thought has historically been a touchstone for Indian politics and civil rights. However, it also has much to say on our relationship to nature. My thinking here does not wish to claim in a linear fashion that Dalit attitudes to environment are somehow better or valorize any Dalit standpoint. There is no golden age here. Some Dalit intellectuals have argued that since Dalits have been closer to nature, therefore they have more cultural and ecological vitality and creativity. Dalits' original environmental, technological, scientific, and productive knowledge have been invoked to claim their role and contribution in all spheres of life in a post-Hindu India. However, Dalit naturalism or romanticism can also be associated as a kind of eco-casteism or caste essentialism. The interrelationship between Dalit and environment is quite complex and conflict-ridden. Here, certainly the anthropocentric or biocentric view of environment, which is based on primarily based on human experiences, does not explain everything. The experiences of a Dalit, untouchable, or an outcast, or of a bonded laborer, often considered as less than a human being, are not compatible with the boundaries of human nature. They challenge us to understand the meanings and implications of nature for those living on the margins of human existence. Dalits have a rich and diverse environment history and sensibility. They have a distinct environmental memory and language. It's also true that Dalits have generally articulated this under the rubric of social, as opposed to explicitly environmental. It may at times be expressed more from the margin than the mainstream, from the local than the national, and be raw rather than the refined. For examples, when Chamars of North India launched a movement called Nara Mavesi movement in mid-60s to shed their polluting caste-based occupations, they had concerns of labor's livelihood, animal and environment. The emergence of land issues in 1960s, 70s, till 1980s was aimed at revisiting land, its origin, its distribution, its occupation, its continuity, and so on and so forth. Such sensibility and knowledge has been evident historically in anti-caste thinking and activism. One of the key principles of Ambedkar, Phule, and Periyar, which I also studied in detail, was how to deal with village, land, agriculture, water, forest, ample space in Ambedkar's, Phule, and Periyar's writing. Dalit voices enlarge and enrich our environmental imagination. There is a wealth of Dalit eco-literature, which is my new work also, that how Dalit nature writing can be also located in India. Poems, painting, stories, music, folklore, coming from diverse regions and communities, Dalit myths and legends of Mayavali, Mayavel and Jasma, Dina and Bhadri, Eklavya and Kabir, underline their dreams and desires for ecological belongings against their suffering, exclusion, and sacrifice. They have their own ecological gods and goddesses, pujas and festival. I'm leaving those details here. Combining snapshots from different historical periods and geographical regions, one can bring out Dalit ecological insights in which the themes of labor, land, water, agriculture, place, myth, music, social justice come out prominently. Attempts at universalization of a space in historical, mythical, and contemporary terms represent a major trends in Dalit environmental activism and thought in many parts of the country. The notion of new commons and its representation as an accessible, universal speciality is crucial for Dalits in nature. Now, at the final part of my talk, I think it will be incomplete without giving you a quick shot of the Dalit imagination about environment. And here I will take you to Dasrath Manji. You might not have heard of Dasrath Manji, who carved a road through the mountain in Gaya district of Bihar for 22 years, day and night. It is said in the memory of his wife, who died after a serious injury inflicted inside the mountain. A man who died in 2007 at the age of 78, had independently and single-handedly brought down a 360 feet long, 25 feet high hill, and created a 16 feet wide pass in place of a almost impenetrable common natural hilly space. Manji has been vividly described as the mountain man, the superman, the hillman of Bihar, the poor man Shah Jahan, the modern day Bhagirath, a record holder in the 1999 Limca books. Well-known Bollywood filmmaker Ketan Mehta made a feature film on Dasrath Manji, named Manji the Mountain Man, that was released in 2015. Film actor Amir Khan visited the village and family of Dasrath Manji in 2014 for his TV show Satyamev Jayate 2. He was symbolically made the chief minister of Bihar for a day by the then and present chief minister of the state, Nitish Kumar. Upon his death, he was given the state funeral by the Bihar government. So such descriptions about him abound that all could be true. However, one can see Dasrath Manjhi from an environmental lens and how a poor, a Dalit, a landless, a bonded laborer, that is called Kamiya in Bihar, perceive and act upon on commons, the common property resources, and how it could be different and distinct from others. Manjhi quoted, I actually had the opportunity to relate with Manjhi as a journalist before I get into the academics for long. For many times I visited to his place, so that's why I have many interviews with Manjhi, and then while I was doing this work, I again revisited his place. So Manjhi equated life with nature. He said, life is nature, a moving, breathing thing. It transforms from one form to another. Transformation means going beyond our form. Environmental values and interventions, environmentalism, as I said, are not always universal. It is characterized by issues of various kinds of gender, caste, ethnicity, race, and culture. I establish the importance of seeing Dasrath Manjhi as an environmentalist with a difference, even when he was never been part of the mainstream environmentalism. Commons, as we know, are often natural resources, lands, forest, mountain, water bodies, ponds, have been a touchstone of different kind of environmentalism in various contexts, understood as common property resources. They refer first to what is public, collective, and common. Second, it is that which is visible, resourceful, and useful. Third, common space, which is open, inclusive, and accessible to all. There are wider and rich case studies about common space, common property resources. I'm not getting into the details here. So come again to a state Bihar, district Gaya, block Atari, village Gehlore. Dasrath Manjhi was born, lived, and died in his place. So Gehlore had been a very isolated village because of the high hill range spreading from Bodh Gaya to Rajgir, a very famous Buddhist place, and blocking it up front. The laborers had to trek through difficult terrain for hours to reach their working fields and nearby markets. Children had to walk 8 kilometers to reach their school and the nearest block towns. Basic medical services were 70, 80 kilometers away. After Manjhi's accomplishment, the distance between his village and the nearby block town has reduced to only 13 kilometers, and a road within the heart of a mountain easily connected the village with the field, school, hospital, and other everyday destinations. There are rich and varied accounts as to why and how Dasrath Manjhi decided to cut through the mountain and carve a road. Manjhi was a, as I said, bonded laborer in his village. A bonded laborer had to work hard throughout the year, tending to the landlord's land, households, animals, full goods, and whatever else the owners asked them to do. One day at noontime, Manjhi's wife, Faguni Devi, was bringing food and water to his workplace. It was a hot, dry day, and Faguni, walking through the mountain slopes, got seriously injured. When he came to know of his wife's injury, he could not take her to the hospital. Faguni endured great pain, died after a few weeks without getting any timely treatment. After some time, Manjhi sold his goats to buy a borer and a hammer, his sole instrument for breaking the mountain. He began breaking the mountain and undertook it with painstaking regularity, which lasted, by several accounts, for 22 years. He was a bonded laborer, so he had to first fulfill his duties to the landlord, and then every day he headed towards the mountain for a few hours with his instruments. His labor was ridiculed, and he was called mad, insane, crazy, but this could never take away his willpower. He was arrested by the forest department in coordination with the local police to get into this common property resources, mountain, and breaking the mountain. He was asked for the forest department to stop making holes in the mountain, as it, the government was the sole claim holder on this mountain. So why Machi? Why this kind of effort for 22 long years? The hills and the bushes were inhabited by the wild dogs, wolves, bears, snakes. As Kamiya and bonded laborers, they had to constantly deal with the dangers, attacks, injuries, and loss due to these animals. Constant struggle with animals for their survivals. At times, he had very ambivalent attitude towards land, forest, and mountain. His feelings were at times negative as he performed such labor on land, forest, and mountain, which was humiliating, backbreaking, and life-risking. He inhabited a natural world of dry land, hard mountain, and fearful forest, and a social world of subjugation, hierarchy, and exclusion. The interaction between the physical and the social shaped his views on the nature and commons. Galore Hill had a compelling presence for the villagers, especially for Mussars, the lowest caste, as it isolated them from the world. Manchi once said, "The mountain is right there by me, by my village, and within my heart. We cannot live at the bottom of the mountain. Instead, we have to be way up on the mountain." Narratives of labor abound around Dasrath Manji. Dasrath Manji once remarked, "If you have to cut down the mountain, you will have to be 6 feet taller than the mountain. If you have to measure up the depth of the sea, you have to be somewhat deeper than the sea itself. Real wealth is the desire of the soul." He went on, I quote, "The mountain did not appear to me as tall as it is made out to be. Nobody is taller than a human being." Dying of cancer, Manchi still wanted to devote himself, now working on the river water, and save the village from the agony of the droughts and floods that comes there every year. Lying on his deathbed, he was saying, I quote, "Mountains and rivers both have to change to keep us alive. Road is not my end. I want to travel through a new path," unquote. So Dasrath Manji, his tireless effort, his labor and life for 22 years around a common can be understood in an ecological framework with natural, social, and physical meanings. The unsurpassable mountain was a constant reminder of his degraded status as he negotiated with it on an everyday basis to reach his workplace as a bonded laborer. It symbolized many personal losses and pains, and yet, working on the mountain, he considered it his very own, his common space, which he could appropriate, carve, and break through his labor. As a Mussar, lower caste, untouchable, he was an environmental other in the village, with almost no rights over the common forest and land resources of the mountain, in which caste domination and unequal resource distribution was paramount. He was deeply uncomfortable with the forms and practices personified in the commons, as they carried within them exclusion, fear, isolation, bondage, pain, thirst, hunger, caste injustices, and of course, his wife's death. Even before the articulation of formal Indian environmentalism, Dasrath Manji could be the harbinger of a distinct ecological sensibility. He desired, loved, worked, and lived for a new common, unbound by the burdens of the old. So, these are, in my talk today, are very fragmentary examples, and two very briefly. So trying to see the Indian environmental caste nature through a Dalit lens, through which we can glean a new ecological universe, a visible Dalit environmental public space, which is often outside the dominant discursive framework, but it very much embedded in the Dalit ecological understanding. Dalit environmentalism is not a finished or any refined kind of a project. However, just think, its relative invisibility is also a sign of the upper caste habitat that we all inhabit within our environmentalism. By exploring differential subject formation in relation to environment, as well as by opening the public secrets of Indian environmentalhood, I try to bring the reading and understanding of caste, Dalit, environmentalism, nature together. We all know that at different times and location, exploration of the interrelationship between gender and nature, race and nature, ethnicity and culture, gender and caste have opened up new political and academic possibilities. We can contribute to such efforts by trying to bring caste, nature, Dalit, politics together. Thank you.